Question Time tonight, Bernard Jenkin, Shadow Defence Secretary. George Galloway, Labour MP, vehement opponent of war with Iraq. Mark Oaten, Chairman of the Liberal Democrats in the House of Commons. And Anne Leslie, award-winning special correspondent for the Daily Mail. And, good evening. Welcome to Tamworth. If you're observant, you may have noticed we're missing Jermaine Greer, who was going to be here but got stuck in a snowdrift in Cambridge, so she'll have to come some other week. And just one thing before we start. Remember, if you want to comment on what's said during the programme, you can send us a message by texting us to us, and you can read what other people watching are saying about the programme as it goes along, which can be fun, and the instructions are there on the screen. Let's take our first question to our panel, who, as ever, don't know what they're going to be asked tonight. And this comes from Nigel Morris, please. Mr. Morris.
Why do the Liberals and the left wing of the Labour Party continually undermine the Prime Minister's determination to rid the world of weapons of mass destruction in Iraq?
Don't clap, because I was going to come to you first. Bernard Jenkin.
Well, that's a question for them, not for me.
Well, you must have a view on it.
The danger is that the Liberals are chasing public opinion polls rather than sticking up for principle. I mean, there are people, and let's be absolutely blunt about this, there are lots of people with very severe doubts about it, but I have my doubts about the Liberals, because I'm sure when military action comes to be taken, they will be there as they were in Kosovo, as they were in the first Gulf War, as they were in the Falklands, and I think there's a certain amount of political posturing that goes on from the Liberal benches which isn't entirely sincere.
Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. I think the position we have taken on this has been absolutely principled. Charles Kennedy has made it quite clear from the start that if you are going to maintain peace in this world, you do it through the international institutions, the United Nations. And we in this issue, I believe, have led public opinion, and this is not a cheap issue where we're trying to get votes. We strongly feel this is an important principle to speak up in a way that the official so-called opposition just are not doing at the moment.
George Galloway.
Well, we've got His Holiness the Pope, the Cardinal Archbishop of Westminster, the Archbishop of Canterbury, the leader of the British forces who went into Kuwait to liberate Kuwait in the last Gulf War. We've got field marshals by the dozen. We've got people from all political stripes backing the Stop the War coalition campaign to stop us going over the cliff with George W. Bush. There must be an awful lot of Liberals and left-wing Labour people in the country if that question was right, because something between 75% and 80% of the people of the country agree with us that there is no case for going to war on the basis of the current evidence and on the likelihood of the whole thing turning into a disaster. The truth is, we, the Liberals, people like me and the others I've mentioned, speak for Britain. I have a letter in my bag from Count Nikolai Tolstoy, a grandee of the conservative right, placing himself under my command in the campaign, a man whom I never thought I'd ever even have a conversation with. But that's the breadth of the support that we have across the world, from kings, sheikhs, presidents. Nelson Mandela today made a blistering attack on George Bush and Mr. Blair for the way they're conducting this crisis. Now, I just don't think you can pigeonhole us as Liberals and left-wing people. This view is shared across the board.
Well, the simple answer to the question is because they are oppositionists. You know, I mean, they don't like Tony Blair. I don't like Tony Blair. I think on this particular issue, he's probably right. But I noticed that George is saying he's got, you know, half the world and all the grandees and all the lobbies and all the sort of useful idiots, as Lenin put it, on his side.
It's a hell of a way to speak about the Pope. And the Daily Mail, whom you work for.
And the Daily
They're
Mail.
They're also against the
Daily
war.
Mail.
She used to work for after that comment, I'd have thought.
No, it's exactly. I mean, unlike some people, I don't vote the entire ticket of whatever party and whatever faction is speaking. I happen to be in a minority at the Daily Mail, thinking on the whole, we do have to do something about Saddam. And it's not because I'm a warmonger. I've actually seen war at close quarters in three continents, including in Iraq. It is a horrible thing to see. but I think we probably do have to go to war. And it seems to me extraordinary that George, who's always going on about, you know, he's got world opinion on his side and so on. I mean, you were saying after 9/11 that there was no evidence that bin Laden was involved with the 9/11 attacks.
That's completely untrue.
No, I'm sorry, I heard you.
That's completely untrue.
Well, you must have...
I said from the first moment it was bin Laden.
You said there
from
is
the first
no
moment.
Evidence.
I said
I'm
nothing.
I'm sorry,
of the
I
kind.
Have just run through you... a program you did where you said there was no evidence the Taliban was involved, there was no evidence this, there was no
Taliban.
Evidence that.
I accused bin Laden in the House of Commons 4 days after the disaster
and
when
then,
the House was recalled.
And then?
And I said, I despise Osama bin Laden. The difference is I've always despised him. When the Americans and the British were giving him guns and money, I despised him.
I don't think this little argument is getting us anywhere. Let's revert to Iraq. Let me go back to the questioner. What's your view?
I'm sure 90% of the population agreed with Neville Chamberlain when he landed at Croydon Airport.
Absolutely
in 1938.
True. Absolutely true.
Nevertheless, this man has started two wars, has murdered millions of people in his own country, gassed them, he's killed his son-in-laws, which I can imagine you might want to do, but this man has to be stopped. Does George Galloway want a million people in the tube in London or something like that with anthrax poisoning provided by Saddam Hussein?
George Galloway, do you believe Saddam has weapons of mass destruction? If so, what would you do about them, and what do you say to his point?
I asked the Iraqi president to let these inspectors in. I hope I wasn't fooling him. I told them that if you let these inspectors in to go through the country, to destroy any remaining stocks of weapons of mass destruction, then we can have a diplomatic end to this. It now looks as if George Bush and Tony Blair had decided long, long ago that they were going to invade and occupy Iraq. But what I say is this, David, an attack on the London Tube, Islamic fundamentalist terrorism, is going to be a much greater danger after you've bombed and burned Iraq and after you've occupied Iraq from killing its wealth.
Bernard Jenkin.
Well, nobody wants to bomb and burn Iraq. And even if military action is taken, I hope we will see the very minimum of bombing and burning in Iraq. Just as, in fact, it turned out, the people of Afghanistan, the war that you opposed there, there were people dancing in the streets as Kabul was liberated.
Well, and
I've walked down, the streets of Kabul with British soldiers who have been mobbed by an adoring population because it's the British soldiers that brought peace and opened the schools and freed the women in Kabul. And I think that's what we want to see in Iraq and Baghdad. And only, it's the choice is Saddam Hussein's. If he actively cooperates with those weapons inspectors, if he takes them to the weapons of mass destruction and says, come and film me dismantling these weapons, as they did, in, for example, in Ukraine when they disarmed. That's what the weapons inspectors are meant to be doing, George. Just getting the weapons inspectors, you can't expect 180 weapons inspectors to find weapons if they're being deceived by the dictator in Baghdad.
Okay, hold on, Mark. Can I come to one or two members of the audience?
I think many of us are probably very suspicious of George Bush's motives for going to war, but in the week when it was celebrating Holocaust Week, I think we have to stand up and be counted.
Okay. And you in the fifth row, the white shirt, yes.
My point is that once we start this process, once we say we're going to war, that's just the beginning. There are no battle lines with this. That's my concern. And the terrorist is the man or the woman sitting next to you on the bus. There are no battle lines on it.
And you, sir, in the second row here.
Put quite simply, in order to give confidence to the troops and us, the British public, in becoming an aggressor towards Iraq, perhaps some of this evidence should be made public. And I'm thinking yesterday that President Bush announced that they're watching materials being moved just prior to a weapons inspector's visit. If he's watching it being moved, it's not beyond the wit of man to inform the inspectors exactly. So they can intercept such movement.
Okay. And
what I think probably surprised and alarmed Saddam was Hans Blix, who is the chief inspector, produced a report saying that we have been deceived in the end, that we have not been told the truth, we have been given the runaround. Now, Hans Blix was somebody who, when he was the head of the atomic agency, which was supposed to be inspecting Saddam's nuclear programme or non-nuclear programme, said that nuclear programme didn't exist in Iraq. He now admits he was fooled. He's probably fooled now. The problem with constantly saying, why don't we have all the evidence, is because the evidence comes from a lot of people within Iraq and outside Iraq, people who have left, which, if you reveal it, is going to mean that those people and their families are going to be killed or destroyed or tortured. The fact is there's an enormous amount of missing armory in the account, in the 12,200-page account, which you're so keen on.
Okay.
And I think that we have to do something before... People talk about there's no smoking gun.
Yes.
What's your reply to this? A smoking gun is once it's been fired.
You cannot... And the gentleman is absolutely right to say we need to see what this evidence is. Now, we're told that Colin Powell is going to make a PowerPoint presentation next Wednesday to the Security Commission. Now, we need to know what this evidence is. This should be made public. If you're going to actually ask our troops and our democracy to make a decision on something as important as this, we need to see the evidence. If then, having seen that evidence and the House of Commons votes in favour of military action, and we have full UN support, then with a heavy heart, the Liberal Democrats would support that action. But until the case is made, we believe the inspectors should be given much more time to carry on their
work.
And
much more time for Saddam to keep on concealing his weapons of mass destruction, which is the whole point.
What I do wish...
Hang on. The woman in pink there, you, madam. And then I want to take a second question on the same subject. You, madam.
Right, this is in relation to what was mentioned earlier by the panel. And I hasten to add that I am neither a racist nor a warmonger. But as someone quite rightly said, that once that first shot fires out in Baghdad, then there are going to be repercussions throughout this country. An article in Sunday's paper by a correspondent stated that 1,200 British Muslims had gone out to join Al-Qaeda's terrorist training in Afghanistan, most of them by way of either being killed or through other reasons have been accounted for. A lot have returned to Britain. The special branch are most concerned that about a dozen of these terrorists are now loose in Britain, and they are raring to go.
All right. The woman in the white pill over there, you went.
A lot of people undoubtedly would like to see Saddam Hussein removed from power, but how do our world leaders expect that to happen? Surely any bombs that the West drop, any troops that go in fighting with all guns blazing, it's only going to be the population that get hurt. Saddam is going to hide away in his palace. He's not going to get the bombs hit on him. It's the population that have already been under awful sanctions by their president that are going to suffer once again, and it's going to be us that does it to them.
And the man in the black jacket there, and I'll come to you at the back, and then I'm going to take a second question on this.
Agreeing in principle with what Anne Leslie said about protecting your intelligence sources and understand why she says that. At the same time, I found it extremely distasteful that 5 minutes after hearing George Bush making the link between Al-Qaeda and Iraq, Tony Blair is doing exactly the same thing. And where's the evidence to back it up? It seems that this is the way things are going. Bush says one thing 1 minute, Blair follows. Without Blair appearing to be the poodle that is often portrayed, he's got to start presenting evidence so that we can understand why these things are being said.
Okay. George Galloway, do you think he's a poodle, the Prime Minister?
Well, I don't know what poodles did to get themselves such a bad name. Poodles are inoffensive creatures who seldom harm anyone. I'm not sure that the analogy is a good one. But I do wish this Goebbelian resort to telling big lies often enough would stop. Hans Blix said the Iraqis were cooperating, and I'm quoting, rather well. The head of the Atomic Agency Inspectorate said that it was not true that Iraq was now trying to rebuild its nuclear weapons potential.
They were fooled both of them.
You may think that, but don't distort what they actually said by telling people they said one thing when they said something
Blix
different.
Blix did say that he thought that Iraq was lying about its production of nerve agents, and he said it didn't have a genuine acceptance
both of
the disarmament that was demanded of it.
Both of them are saying what the rest of the governments in the Security Council and the vast majority of people in the world are saying, is that this process has to be given more time. After all, the consequences of going to war are very serious for our own sons and daughters that we send into battle, for the thousands of Iraqi children, like little Victoria Colombier, who'll be scalded and killed in their homes under the bombs, like the children and old people who are living in terror waiting for the dive bombers at the moment, and the tremendous boost that bin Laden and the other lunatics, the Islamic fundamentalist terrorists, will get from this confrontation of East and West. That's okay. What bin Laden tried to bring about.
No, no, hold on. I'm going to go on to another question. Can you use it there, perhaps? I want to have another question on this subject from Thomas Lawrence, please. Mr. Lawrence.
Should we let the supposed threat of Saddam Hussein ruin our relationship with European countries such as France and Germany?
France and Germany, who have come out at the moment against, and other countries in Europe, of course, signed this advertisement or article or whatever it was today. Should we let our relationship with the rest of, well, with European countries be ruined, France and Germany? Mark Oaten, you're pro-European.
I am. I think we're going to find that probably most of these European countries come around to having basically the same view. The French have an incredible tradition of starting off saying no, they move to maybe, and they nearly always end up saying yes. And I suspect we're going to see that's what happens. What I think is important...
Jenkin says that's like the Liberal Democrats.
Well, the Liberal Democrats will actually take a judgment on this issue. Look. Berner's quite happy just to make his mind up and just bypass the United Nations. That is not our position. We will wait and see what the United Nations and the weapons inspectors find. And that has got to be the most sensible view.
All right, let's stick with France and Germany. Anne Leslie.
Yes, well, France, in my view, will come round in the end because it's taking a decision which is purely, and I don't blame it, on its own commercial interests. It has a lot of contracts in Iraq and with Iraqi businesses. It also likes very much to cock a snook at America. That's a sort of standard thing about them. Germany has got a very strong pacifist streak because Germany knows very well that when it wasn't pacifist, it plunged Europe into two world wars.
Saving your grace, we don't want the history. The question is whether we should let our relationship be ruined with these countries.
I don't think it will be ruined. I think the French will come around. Once they've done a deal behind closed doors about the sorting out of what the contracts are going to be, what the oil contracts are going to be, I think that France will come round. Germany is a different issue because of the people are very pacifist because of their own experience. Secondly, Gerhard Schröder won the last election. I covered that campaign simply because he said, no way will we go to war with Iraq. And because he appealed to the pacifist feeling in Germany, that's okay. So I think we can ignore those two things because I think they will come round.
The woman at the back there, in red.
The gentleman over here says about ruining the relationship with France and Germany. What relationship with France and Germany?
Questioner seems to be applauding that. Do you agree with that? What?
Yeah, because they stitch us up all the time, don't they?
Or we won't achieve anything, surely.
You think we should be unified?
We've got to be unified, surely.
Well, I think what demonstrates, if we were unified, we wouldn't be able to achieve anything because we're independent. It turns out, and because countries like Spain and Portugal and the Czech Republic and Hungary and Italy that have all signed the support for the American and the British position, it shows their independence is a far better guarantee of our independence than getting into some kind of common foreign policy, which quite clearly couldn't possibly work when we can't agree on fundamental issues like Iraq.
Okay. Can we get right over to the right there, to the man at the very back there, on the right-hand side, if it's possible to reach him? Yes, it is. Far away. The man in the red jacket.
Is it right that Tony Blair and other leaders of other nations can decide whether we go to war or not, or is public opinion important?
What about Parliament? I mean, shouldn't Parliament have a vote on this? Shouldn't the MPs, who are the democratically elected people to represent you, surely we should have a vote and a say in a full debate in Parliament on this issue?
Didn't you accept what the Prime Minister said at Prime Minister's Questions on Wednesday?
No, I don't believe that.
Well, you don't believe what he said. He said that he'd have a vote and he can't.
Yes, but not before it's too late.
It's the timing.
We've voted umpteen times on whether it's okay to kill foxes, but we've not been allowed a single vote on whether it's okay to kill thousands of people in Iraq.
Okay. The man in blue there. You said it. No, the man in blue, and then I'll come to you. Yes.
The comment earlier about carving up of oil resources surely demonstrates that this whole conflict is
exactly.
about human
exactly.
rights or intervention or chemical weapons, but it's about future supplies of oil.
Exactly.
End of story.
The sordid reality.
And the man in the Fair Isle pullover.
My point also, Anne Leslie let out slip oil,
yep.
and that finished the rest of the argument.
No, of course. Of course this war. Can I respond to
yes,
that?
Yes, yes, please.
Of course this war is partly about oil, because frankly, if all that Saddam Hussein produced or his country produced were carrots, nobody would give a toss, frankly, whether he was killing his own people, gassing his own Kurds, and so on. Oil is important. The reason he invaded Kuwait was because he was annoyed with the Kuwaitis for undercutting his ability to charge more for his oil and therefore to be able to produce his nuclear program and his weapons of mass destruction. Of course it's about oil, partly about oil, but it is also partly about what they say it's about. You wouldn't agree. It's about weapons of mass destruction. If you have a man who is a psychopath, a murderer, who is in charge of the literal lubricant of modern industrial society, this is incredibly dangerous for us. How many of us arrive by car or who go to schools that are heated by oil or go to hospitals that are heated by oil? When we say it's only about oil, as if it was a trivial issue, it is not a trivial issue. And it seems to me that we have to take into account that he can destroy Western civilization by dominating the oil fields of the Middle East, which have three quarters of the world's oil.
Okay, that's fine. George, very briefly, if you would, and then
we've got a dangerous psychopathic murderer in charge of weapons of mass destruction. He's just got a thumping. He's just got a thumping new majority in General Sharon in Israel, and he's got a mountain of weapons that we gave him.
I
wanted to deal with the European question. Mr. Blair said that we were going to be at the heart of Europe, and we're turning out to be a cancer inside Europe, a tumor acting for American interests inside Europe. To say that we're independent when we're actually synchronizing our policy statements, they're made in Washington and 5 minutes later, as the questioner said, they're made in London.
George.
We've become the 51st state of George W. Bush's United States of America.
George, it's not for nothing that George is known in political circles as the honorable member for Baghdad South.
Well,
he is acting in Iraq.
If you're not careful, I'll tell people what you're known as in Flitzkrieg.
A fat old bag, but I don't mind that because that doesn't.
It's much worse than that.
All right. Let's cut out this insult.
And finally, on the poodle question. This is a man who goes and spends Christmas in Baghdad.
I spent Christmas in the next beach to Tony Blair in Egypt. I was waving at him across the sand dunes.
Well, it's all very interesting. I'm not sure it's totally relevant. We'll move on to another subject. Thanks very much. Just before we do, question time next week is going to be in Dartmouth in Devon. A week after that, we're going to be in Carnarvon in Wales. Now, we'd like you to come very much to those question times, and if you'd like to, the thing to do is simply to ring us. The number's on the screen now. 09011114411. Or you can, of course, as always, apply on our website, bbc.co.uk/question time. You can argue about these issues there too, and you'll see your views published. And do keep your questions coming, or remarks coming, by texting us in the way that's described on the screen. Let's have another question now. This one is from Joanna Carey, please. Joanna Carey.
Did the wrongful conviction of Sally Clark confirm that there is no presumption of innocence for mothers of cot death victims?
The wrongful conviction of Sally Clark, did it confirm no presumption of innocence for mothers of cot death victims? Bernard Jenkin.
Well, what I find so distressing about this whole case is how what is obviously a terrible family tragedy finishes up with police and handcuffs and the Crime Prosecution Service and the whole weight of the law being thrown around just to investigate what's happened. And it seems to me we need to look at how we approach these cases, that it's not necessarily somewhere for the law to intervene immediately, that the suspicion of the commission of a crime tends to drive out the perhaps more humane responses and more humane investigation that should have taken place to avoid this injustice in the first place. And I think we need to have a long look at the whole law that surrounds this.
I don't entirely follow you. Are you saying that two cop deaths shouldn't be followed up by the police?
Well, what I'm suggesting is that the law of murder and a police investigation might not necessarily be the best institutions to follow up two cot deaths. What might be more appropriate is a far softer approach, because I don't think many mothers go around intentionally murdering their children unless there is some terrible problem in that family or there's some illness. I think that is the lesson of this case. I don't pretend to be an expert, but when I read about it in the papers this morning and heard about it on the radio, I just couldn't help feeling that there should have been something more humane in this case.
Joanna Carey, you asked a question. Are you a lawyer or a law student?
No, I'm a law student.
Law student. What do you think?
Well, I think that it's very difficult to prove that you haven't killed a child. If the onus of proof is on the mother, how on earth is she supposed to do that? If the medical experts can't agree that what the child died of, how can she refute that?
And Leslie?
Joanne, I think the main problem is that we don't actually know quite enough about cop deaths. I mean, for example, recently geneticists have been discovering that a child is extremely vulnerable to infection about 8 to 12 weeks after the child has been weaned, because you inherit a lot of your mother's immune system to begin with. Then if the immune system of the child doesn't kick in at that point, then they are very, very susceptible to infections. And most cot deaths occur during that time. We're learning a lot more about cot deaths. I don't know whether it's a question of whether we should be more humane or anything like that. What I think we should be asking about is the quality of the pathologist's reports. One of the pathologists said the chances of two cot deaths in one family are 1 in 73 million. It turns out, if anything, it's about 1 in 100, and it may be even less. The other one concealed, it seems to me, evidence of a severe staph infection in the second child. These are questions which I think are more serious, because I think it's very difficult to say whether two cop deaths in one family means murder. But I think what we have to say is that in these cases, you must have pediatric pathologists, not general pathologists, because a pediatric pathologist knows more about child development and baby development and immune systems and so on than the general one who goes around, you know, as in movies and things, you know, just picking up.
They did ask. Things. They did ask. I heard this evening in a discussion about this, the lawyer for Sally Clark said that they did ask for a child pathologist, a pediatric pathologist, and the police apparently said, no, our pathologist is adequate.
But he was a general pathologist.
Yes,
he was doing all sorts
indeed.
Of murder cases.
The man in the yellow tie there.
It is outrageous what's happened to that lady. You just have to look at the pictures of her before her trial and the pictures that we saw her on her acquittal at the Court of Appeal. It's ruined her life. It's possibly gone a long way to ruining many good other lives as well. I was going to raise the point that Anne Leslie did mention about that the paediatrician who gave that grossly misleading statistic, and that's the sort of thing that's got to be eradicated from our system.
What saddens me is that...
Hold on a second, Anne, I'll come back to you in a moment. The man there with the black... Yes, you said... No, you've got a black shirt on, at least it looks like it.
Right, yeah. Sorry. Yeah, it seems to me as though, from what we've heard, that some information has been withheld as well, vital information, and it makes me wonder whether our justice system, our system is trying to actually determine the truth or just gain a conviction.
That's right.
Okay. And you, ma'am, and here in the front row. Yes.
Although this pathologist wasn't a paediatric pathologist, is he going to face any charges?
Well, he's having some inquiries made at the moment.
Withholding this vital evidence?
Okay.
I think there's several issues we need to learn from the case. The first is just the length of the whole procedure. When somebody has got such a strong case for appeal, why does it just take so long? Secondly, there was and has already been an appeal, and they went through the appeal process, and none of this came up even through that appeal process. So what went wrong there? Thirdly, the jury asked for some of this information to be given to them, but it was actually withheld from the first jury, so something's gone wrong there. And then finally, I think we do need to learn much more about the whole question of cot death, postnatal depression, all of these issues. There is so much misinformation and lack of understanding. So I hope, from what is an awful story, it's a lovely story in another way, the way in which a husband and wife just hung together and stayed through this so strongly. I hope some good can come of it, and never again, when this kind of thing is raised again, will we have the kind of medical evidence just brushed over. I think some very serious questions will be asked in every court case which follows, and that at least will be some good that's come from this awful case.
But the tragic thing is that the thing about the Clarks, they were a loving, middle-class, legally trained couple. They could go on fighting. There are other cases of women who are in prison, who are working class, who don't have that knowledge, who don't have that clout, who don't have stars like Martin Bell, you know, campaigning on their behalf. And I think that is really seriously dangerous.
Okay. The man in the front row here. And
yeah, I'm surprised that such a grossly misleading statistic like that wasn't picked up by somebody else in the court at the time when it was read out.
Or by a colleague, indeed.
Or either by the judge or the jury. I mean, if I was in the jury and heard a statistic like that, the first thing I'd do is, you know, check out that fact for myself, because it even sounds completely ridiculous.
George Galloway.
Well, yeah, statistics, damned lies and statistics are used all the time to bamboozle people, and unless they've got the expertise to challenge it, they often go unchallenged. But the original question was about the presumption of innocence, and I actually think the presumption of innocence is being steadily and quite dramatically eroded in this country. We've seen it in a number of cases recently, paedophile cases, for example, where the media find somebody guilty, or rape cases, where they found somebody guilty before the matter has even started the due legal process. We've seen it in terrorist cases. And in this case, I think you're right. The woman was held to be responsible for proving her own innocence. And of course, the process of the trial was appalling. I just say this, David, lastly. If this woman had lived in Texas, she'd have been electrocuted by now. And so for those who still cling to the idea that it's a good idea to execute people and have the death penalty, this woman, for killing two children, would have been executed by now.
Right.
It does talk a lot of nonsense. I'm against the death penalty, but they don't execute women who've been accused of...
That's not true.
That's absolutely untrue. They've just done it in America. They've just killed a woman. Killed her children. She drove them into a lake and let them drown.
Yes, that
you
was
do
not
talk nonsense, Anne. You
not
do talk nonsense.
All right.
She was convicted of murder. She was convicted of murder.
And in the United States,
a woman has just been executed for precisely this:
not
killing her
death.
Children.
Not
These were not caught deaths, they were murder, according to the jury.
They should have their own show.
I think we're moving around in a moment.
Do calm down.
Oh, Robin. You're telling me to calm down.
Robin McConnell, please. Mr. McConnell, can you stir things up for us?
Do you think John Prescott, as a former active union official, is right to change the law to end a democratically balloted strike by the firefighters?
Mark Oaten.
It's gone on too long. I've got concerns about this dispute because clearly with the troops who are having to step in and the pressure that may be on them in the next couple of months, we need to settle this very quickly. But because we need to settle it quickly, I actually think Prescott is wrong. If you really want to resolve this issue, then the kind of macho language which he's talking about forcing a government settlement on these individuals, is actually just going to harden opinion amongst the firefighters. What I think we should put in place is some form of compulsory arbitration, so that we actually force both sides to get back round the table and discuss this issue.
What's compulsory arbatration?
Compulsory, basically what the government is
talking
about.
Supposing they disagree, what do you do then?
Well, this should be the next step that is taken. Now, it may very well be that we end up with a point where you do have to impose a settlement, but we're not there yet.
What is compulsory arbitration? You go to jail if you don't go to the arbitration? You get fined? How do you work compulsory arbitration?
You require both sides to go around, sit around the table, and actually have independent arbitration.
But what's your clout to do that?
The same clout that the government is suggesting and putting in place, that ultimately there'll be an end process where you will have to take control on this. But at the moment, the government aren't talking about getting around
Bernard
the table.
Bernard Jenkin, what do you think about Prescott's intervention?
Well, what John Prescott's actually talking about is taking powers to impose a settlement, but that won't actually settle the strike. What he has at his disposal now is powers which the Labour government used in the 1970s to stop a fire strike, when they decided it was a threat to public safety, and they keep saying it is a threat to public safety. They could apply to the court for an injunction and stop the strike now. And that's what we're suggesting he should do. And then there would be nowhere for the union to go but, I suppose, compulsory arbitration.
But you would actually say you would stop the strike. What would you do if they refused to go back to work?
Well, what you do is you put an injunction on the union to stop organising the strike. That's legislation that's worked before, and it's legislation that a Labour government has used
before. And if they ignore it, what
well,
do you do?
Well, it will work. It's worked before, has been used before, and it will work. The tragedy of the present strike is that the firefighters have been led up the garden path by their union. The leader of the fire brigades union is like a latter-day Arthur Scargill. He's led his people up a blind alley. There's no possibility that the government is going to give any kind of settlement along the lines that he's suggesting. And in fact, the longer that it goes on, like Arthur Scargill's miners, the more firefighters are going to lose their jobs and the more fire stations are going to be closed by the government.
Let me go to the question.
And it would be far better if they got back to work to start with, took the pressure off the armed forces, which is a disgrace, and shouldn't be happening, and settled down to the practical discussions about how to settle the dispute rather than carrying on with what is now quite obviously a pointless strike. And I fear most of the firefighters know that,
right,
but they don't know how to get out of
Robin McConnell, what do you think? You asked the question. What's your view?
I would like a negotiated settlement. I'd be very concerned about any imposition of law. As a trade union member for most of my working life, it would go against the grain for me to have the weight of the law to decide this strike. And I think there's a world of difference between Andy Gilchrist and Arthur Scarwell.
Okay.
Mr. Gilchrist at least took the action on the back of a democratic ballot, which Mr. Scargill didn't.
Okay. And you said the third rather.
Just a couple of points. Being a trade union official myself, I believe Mark Oaten is correct. There has to be a negotiated settlement. I think Mr. Jenkin is an absolute disgrace when he calls firefighters idiots.
I never called them idiots.
I believe if Mr. Jenkin's house was burning down, is he saying he would ring up a bunch of idiots? I think he's a disgrace,
well,
there has to be a settlement.
I certainly think the fire brigades union are a bunch of idiots because I think they've led the firefighters up the garden path.
Rubbish.
But the firefighters themselves, I think they're a fantastic bunch and they should be recognised as such. And this union
is that recognised by 4% in job cuts? And
well, can I
you
just
award yourself
but the thing is,
pay award?
I'm in Parliament at the moment to speak for the armed forces. They haven't had a 4% increase in years. The average squad is.
Are you saying that the firefighters who you admire aren't any longer supporting the strike?
I think you'll find
this. Or you admire them, but they are supporting the strike, which you disagree with.
I admire the work they do, which is frequently difficult and dangerous, but the soldiers who are doing that job, when the firefighters are on strike, are already paid much less. They have to modernise. It's called Queen's Regulations. They don't have a chance to go on strike to negotiate their terms of conditions. They also can be called overseas, possibly to die for their country. And I think it's a disgrace that the Fire Brigades Union is disrupting the family lives of soldiers who may be going abroad to fight for their country when the firefighters themselves are already paid substantially more than soldiers.
You convinced by that?
And they get second jobs.
Absolutely not. I'm sure the firefighters would love the sort of pay rise Mr. Jenkin had and other MPs had over the last few years.
The lady in the fourth row there, you, ma'am.
Mr. Blair wants to stop pussyfooting about and
quite
give
right.
him a decent wage.
George Galloway.
Firefighters, every time they turn up for work, are ready to die for their country. And the union is not some other. The union is made up of the brave men and women that if you call them 999 tonight, will be ready to plunge into a burning building for money that Bernard Jenkin wouldn't get out of bed for. Let me assure you about that.
So what do you think of John Prescott's action?
I think it's a despicable act. And I think that it has turned the stomach of genuine, decent Labour people the length and breadth of the country. And I hope he knows that he's being made a patsy by the Cabinet when they put him up to do it. The man with his credentials, his background, his trade union history, to be put up to stab the firefighters in the back is an absolutely despicable act of treachery.
He never looks so. he never looks like a patsy.
No, and I was one of those campaigning for him to be the leader of the Labour Party in 1994, and I'm absolutely, I think he might have done a better job than has been done, but anyway, he didn't get the job. But I'll tell you what job he's got now. The job he's got now is to be put up to spit on his own history, to spit on everything he used to believe in. And these firefighters are an integral part, a pillar of the Labour Party. They've stood by the Labour Party in dark days, and for the government to be effectively making them forced labour, because that's what it's called, this binding arbitration and forcing them back to work, that's called slavery in other countries.
The police
okay. Men, slaves. Men and women, men and women in a free country are entitled. Look, if we've got money to go around the world setting fire to other people's countries, we've got money to pay the firefighters a decent wage.
George Galloway, thank you. And Leslie, and the brief,
I've
would.
Always thought that this whole dispute was a question of lions, i.e. the firefighters led by donkeys, i.e. the FBU, and now we're going to put in another donkey, try and sort it out, John Prescott. What I believe is that the FBU made such a mess of this dispute with a 40% increase, which is more than, you know, nurses were getting and so on. And this idea that George has is that all the firefighters do all the time is running into buildings rescuing, you know, burning babies.
Anytime.
Nonsense.
Anytime.
10% of their time is spent on that.
They I don't know which 10%.
Exactly. No, I respect. And, I respect.
And the rest of the time, they're dragging out people from traffic accidents and doing things like that.
No, they're not doing it.
Yes,
they're
doing
a lot of other things.
They are doing that.
What
they have an enormous increase in work for that.
This is somebody who gets £100,000 a year for pontificating in a newspaper.
How do you know about my salary?
All right. Now, before you two start again.
The same
it's like having terrible twins on the programme. Look, could you?
Why don't we do a music hall act? At
well,
the
let's
end of
let's
the
no let's do the let's do John Prescott and the union the credit of taking the issue seriously. Could you just answer this and then we'll move on? Do you think that John Prescott is right to change the law to try and bring an end to the strike?
I think that yes or no? Probably it's the only alternative, particularly if we are on the brink of war. I'm sorry that it's going to be him in charge. And he hasn't got to change the law. There are sections of the law, 1947 and so on, which will enable him to do it. So he's not having to change the law. I think, in fact, if we went to war, I think the firefighters themselves would call off the strike and settle for what they're offered.
Okay, I'm going to take one more point from the man in the yellow tie there who's waving his hand vigorously, and I would have brought you in, but I'll bring you on the next one. Yes?
Yeah, it's been reported by John Prescott that the strikes cost £70 million of the taxpayers' money. Isn't it time that the strikes ended now?
A million a day is what he says. Yeah. Well, that's your view. Okay. Yeah. On that note, I'm going to move on. And this is a question, please, from Claire Strain. Claire Strain.
Are the Conservatives trying to sneak the asylum seekers' issue onto the anti-terrorist bandwagon in order to gain popular support for it?
Conservatives sneaking the asylum seekers' issue onto the anti-terrorist bandwagon to gain popular support. George Galloway?
Yes, they are, and not only the Conservatives. Many others from whom it's less expected are doing the same thing. This conflation of asylum, immigration, race, Islam, and war and terrorism is being made deliberately to stir up people's feelings against the other, against the alien, to build support for war. By Bernard Jenkins' party and also by some people who should be even more ashamed of themselves. Don't get me wrong.
Who are the people who should be even more ashamed of themselves?
Well, there are all sorts of people who are making the most reckless statements. I'll just name one of them. The Home Secretary, David Blunkett, who actually lectured people on speaking their own language in their own house. He said they'd get schizophrenic if they didn't speak English, even in their own houses. And I think that that kind of casual, reckless statement helps build the kind of support for racist ideas that led to a fascist party winning a seat on the Halifax Council just a couple of days ago. We need to cool this issue. All responsible people of whatever political stripe, if they want to have a harmonious country, should be cooling this issue down, not inflaming it by throwing petrol on the fire. Okay.
Bernard Jenkin.
Well, it gets to a pretty pass, doesn't it, when you cannot actually discuss what is a very major issue, which is the question of asylum, because some left-wing lunatic's going to jump on you and say you're stirring up a racist war. I tell you what gives a purchase for the fascists to win council elections. It's the complacency of politicians who somehow think this doesn't matter, so that people who live in areas where they have high ethnic populations begin to feel genuinely afraid about who is living in their area. So what we've got to do is, first of all, get a grip of who is coming in and out of our country, get control of our borders, make sure that we identify the terrorists before they come in, so that people don't think that's an asylum seeker, that must be a terrorist, because that is the situation we've got, because we have lost control of the asylum issue. We also need to look at giving genuine refugees a fairer deal, because they're the people that get caught up in all this, because the asylum system is overloaded with people who aren't genuine asylum seekers. We need to address, this is the policy we announced this week, the whole question of Article 3 of the European Commission on Human Rights, which stops, even if you identify a terrorist who's come in pretending to be an asylum seeker, you can't deport that terrorist back to their country of origin under the European Commission on Human Rights. That's clearly crazy. We've got a lot of work to do, but the government has got itself tied in knots. It's desperately split on this issue, and the issue is going nowhere. So I make no apology for launching a policy this week to deal with the fact that it is quite obvious that one of the ways that the terrorists are trying to get into this country is by walking in and claiming an asylum, or even getting into this country and then claiming asylum as from in country.
The woman in the second row. From there.
A genuine asylum seeker who was actually deported back to Kosovo this Sunday, and we had a horrendous time trying to do everything by the book, and we actually paid for him to go back, and we did everything by the book. We paid for legal advice and things like that, and all the time it really opened my eyes seeing how many people, how many false claims and things. But what I'm actually saying is, as my husband, he's been my husband for 15 months, we've been together for 3 years, we were stopped quite a few times when he was in the car, and he was stopped by police sometimes and saying, what's your name, are you a Muslim? The last few years has been very difficult, and it's opened my eyes to what black people have had to encounter, because I live in Birmingham, and he's now back, and we're trying to go through the process from Kosovo. Now we can't do it in Kosovo because they...
But what do you think of the government and the Conservative Party's attitude to asylum seekers?
Well, I'm not very good. I do appreciate it's that the whole system is absolutely choking at the seams, and people, my colleagues, my friends, cannot believe that we've tried. We are real. I'm British and we're married, but we can't. We've done everything by the book, and yet the system is just too vast. The corruption, the bribery, and there's so much to say.
Okay.
But it's,
okay. Anne Leslie's nodding in agreement, and Patrick Jenkin, Bernard Jenkin. Sorry, I've done that before. Is nodding in agreement.
Well, I totally agree. The problem is a complete shambles. So nobody can tell who is genuine, who is not, the amount of corruption, the false ID cards, and so on and so forth. And it's got to the stage where, frankly, if Saddam Hussein, George's great friend, with whom he shares so many...
Let's just stick to the point. Let's not trade insults. Let's try and get these questions answered. Otherwise, it's a waste of time.
He could send his entire Republican Guard to Dover, where they could then claim asylum, and be allowed in and disappear into the woodworks. It is a shambles. And so your husband is suffering as much as anybody from the shambles.
I think the fact that he's a Muslim, this has been a situation because he's a Muslim. He's had really quite a bad experience. But we've been stopped. He's been stopped many times in the car and looked for papers and your surname. And we've really noticed it a lot.
Okay, the man in the dark pool over there, second... Yes, you, sir.
I've been friends with a Muslim for a year now, and I've been he's a driver, and I've been in his car for the past year now, and he hasn't been stopped once. So how can you claim that just because he's been stopped in his car is a claim on just because he's an asylum seeker?
Okay, and you, sir, in the front here, with the blue tie on?
Yes,
I think it's about time we move back to conservative-based principles, where compassion is exercised with objectivity and would enable them to everybody to get a control of this situation.
Right. So you would want to see the law toughened up and asylum seekers imprisoned while they're checked or put in
secure...
Imprisoned
is an emotive term, but yes. Certainly compassion with objectivity.
Yes. And you, madam, in the... Yes, you in the pink.
Yes, because I think that 95% of these are not asylum seekers. They are illegal immigrants.
Okay, you think they're not genuine?
All right.
Yes? No, don't read it. Just speak your mind.
What I must say is that all Mr. Blair says is more dramatic steps need to be taken. How true. Let's get rid of him as Prime Minister.
Okay. And the man in the front row here on the left, please.
Okay, I mean, I find it quite amazing that so-called intelligent people can sit there and just for a small political gain, they can kind of attack these asylum seekers and say, why are they coming here? Being a second generation, my father, he came here through asylum. The reason why these people come here, the reason why these people, they get on board things that can hardly be called boats to escape what's happening in their lands and the devastation that has been caused on their lands is directly due to the colonization of their lands by the West. And these people, they come to seek refuge from these. So if you want to solve the problem of asylum seekers, then I think you really need to go deeper on this and kind of solve the reasons why these people are coming from.
Right. Marco, please.
It's worth acknowledging that I think Bernard's language tonight was tolerant and measured on this issue. Unfortunately, not all politicians have actually taken that position, and I've heard some pretty outrageous remarks in the past. It is difficult as a politician because, you know, you want to get clapped by an audience like this, but I'm going to say things that you probably won't agree with and you might want to boo about. But I feel very passionately that we ought to have a much more tolerant approach on this whole issue. That we ought to not have inflammatory language, and we ought not to have this rather macho battle in some of the right-wing press to see who can work up the nasty headlines on asylum seekers. There is a lot of nonsense written about, frankly, on this issue. What I do think needs to happen is that we must, yes, speed the process up. I don't think it's going to be effective to start ripping up international treaties. I don't think the Conservatives' idea of building these centres all over the country is practical. It will cost a lot of money. And even in their own shadow Home Secretary's constituency, nobody wants the suggested centre there anyway. What we must do is speed the process up, tackle this, and also work with our European partners so that they do also take some of the burden of this issue as well.
Okay. The woman in the second row, you madam, then I'm going to... Yes.
Could we also cover the cost to the National Health Service of the asylum seekers coming in with the health risks that they bring with them, i.e. TB, smallpox?
Okay. Yes, you, sir, with the spectacles on there.
Thank you very much. A genuine asylum seeker would come to the first country that offered him a safe haven. And I feel that these are not genuine asylum seekers when they're prepared to hang off the back of trains, sit in freezing lorries and come to a country which they think is a soft touch.
Okay. Well, we talked about asylum seekers last week and this week and no doubt next week as well because it's a key issue. But I want to go on to a final question from Richard McDermid. Richard McDermid, please.
Yes. What's the panel's views on the new sex law reforms outlined by the Home Office, which allows gay men to engage in having sex in public lavatories?
What's your view of it?
My view is that I've got no problem with sexuality of any person, but I do believe that it should be done within their own private houses or hotels, but not in a public lavatory.
Apparently also, people are allowed to do it in their bedrooms with the curtains open, even if it can be seen from the street, but not in the garden.
Correct, yeah. That's right.
Anne Leslie, what do you think about these reforms,
so-called reforms? Well, I thought public lavatories were for relieving yourself of, certain... fluids which were not connected.
Careful! I think we better move on to somebody else if this is going to be
no,
the tenor of your answer.
No, but what I'm going to say is that a friend of mine who took his small children into a public lavatory, he had no idea this was well known in the quote-unquote gay community as a cottage. And he was absolutely thunderstruck at what he saw and the abuse he got when he said, oh, you know, and the little boys were rushed out. I think public laboratories should be for their original purposes.
Okay. George Galloway.
Well, she's bashed the asylum seeker. She's bashing the gays, my God. I just think we're
too,
hung up about these things. I'm amazed we've got legislative time to legislate on this kind of rubbish, frankly. There are far more important things that we should be getting down to, if you'll pardon the pun, in the in the British Parliament than where people have sex or not.
And in a public lavatory. I mean, well, they can have it anywhere they like. Well, why do they have to go into a public lavatory where parents, well, you know, take their small children?
I mean, I don't even know if that is in the legislation. I very much doubt if it's framed in those terms. I'm frankly...
Well, I quote Tony Benn's son, Hillary, who's the Home Office Minister involved, who said, if the cubicle door is open and an offence is committed, if it's closed, it's different. I don't want to go into much more detail on this.
Why did you choose this
Bernard
question?
Jenkin. Well, no, Richard McDermott asked it. Yeah.
Public conveniences are not meant to be threatening places. They're meant to be places where you feel safe. And I can imagine, as Anne found out, that without wishing to cast any aspersions on the gay community, I'm not anti-homosexual. In fact, I was one of the first Conservatives to vote for the equalisation of the age of consent. But I think that public lavatories might become more threatening than they need to be. I mean, there are actually gaps under the doors. So what constitutes a closed door, I ask you? I want to look at this legislation. I haven't studied this. I think I saw a picture in one of the newspapers, but decided it wasn't work to read that bit.
Mark Oaten, very briefly, because we're coming to the end.
Briefly, I hope we're moving to a more tolerant society where gay men don't feel they have to go and hide in public lavatories, but can actually be in society and have relationships in society. And as for the other issue about sex in the garden, I'm a liberal and a democrat, so as far as I'm concerned, you can do most things where you like, as long as the other person agrees.
And the neighbours. The man in the white pullover, just very briefly, if you would, sir.
Is it not the case that the whole of the Sexual Offences Act actually needs to be looked at, and we shouldn't be just targeting one group of people? We should look at the whole issue of sex offence and address it accordingly.
Yes, to be fair to the legislation, it does. The questioner just put this particular point. It does have a fairly wide-ranging effect, which we can't go into now because our hour is up. And it just falls to me to thank our panel very much indeed. For coming here to Tamworth, to thank all you for taking part in the programme. We're going to be in Dartmouth next week, and we're going to have on the panel the former Education Secretary, Estelle Morris, Eric Forth, the Shadow Leader of the Commons, Shirley Williams, the Liberal Democrat Leader in the Lords, Billy Bragg, the musician, and A.N. Wilson, the novelist. Those will be our five, snow permitting. And if you'd like to join us in Bournemouth, or if you'd like to come to Carnarvon the following week, remember to ring this number, it's on the screen, 09011 114 411, or go to our website, bbc.co.uk/questiontime, where you can comment on tonight's programme. And if I said Bournemouth instead of Dartmouth, I can't think why. I go to Dartmouth much more often than I go to Bournemouth, and a very admirable place. So anyway, you can comment on tonight's debate there. You can also tell us who you'd like to see on other editions of this programme. So do join us again next Thursday. In the meantime, from all of us here, good night.